Welcome to the roundtable, the impact of having cherished materials and life on societal and economic challenges. I want to thank our speakers for accepting the invitation to participate, and I also want to thank Dr. Muccini for inviting me as moderator of this roundtable. And thanks to his collaborators, Gabriella Leo, Dr. Vera, and all the persons that helped to organize this event. You know, 2015 is the International Year of Light, and that's why it's at the core of this workshop. It's one of the reasons. We know light is everywhere. Except for black holes, but light is even everywhere, or almost everywhere in our technologies, like it's the frontier of science, something that is put forward every day, from communication to manufacturing, from quality control to safety. And light is in many fields and has to do with many competitive industries. And you already know the roundtable is bring together point of view of policy making, institutions, public research, business, to debate on the economic and societal impact of research and innovation in chemistry, advanced material and lighting technologies. We have here six persons there at the table that I think are among the most influential and distinguished, qualified to help us discussing this item. They feature six different points of view, but they also have many linked one to each other, I think. Professor Luigi Nicolais is the president of CNR, and probably it's not necessary that I explain what CNR is. Mr. Nicolais is. He's an engineer, anyway, and he has a long experience as a researcher and professor at the university, but also had political roles. The Minister of now is President of CNR since 2012. And so he can give us the point of view of a great research institution, but holding together the experience of the researcher and the political problems. Dr. Patrizio Bianchi is an economist. He's been teaching applied economy for many years and he was provost or chancellor of Rada University, but he's mainly an expert of industrial economy. So he is here because he's in charge of European politics, development school, university and research for the Emilia-Romagna government, but we can say he's a technician too. Dr. Lula Rosso is also a former researcher. She's got a huge experience studying molecular simulation and biometric imaging at the Imperial College in London. She told me she always looks for something that has a social impact, and surely her present role has this. She's now a research program officer for the EU program Horizon 2020, and I think this is a critical role to promote research and help researchers to put their best. Marcus Wilkins is a biologist and engineer, but today he's above all a technology consultant. He is senior technology consultant at the VDI Technology Center and is managing the European Technology Platform Photonics 21 since its foundation. Photonics 21 is a PPP, a public-private partnership benchmark. So we can say he's an expert in how to interface research, industry, and politics. That is what we are going to discuss today. Mauro Precolani has a long experience in venture capital. I mean, not tell you all of his position, it should be boring. He's now senior investment advisor of the Venture Capital Fund of Funds, Fondo Italiano di Investimento, that means he's covering the allocation of capital to venture capital funds investing in the Italian market. He knows, or is supposed to know, how to manage together finance and research, and how research can become attractive for investors that can finance it, even a research that wheels to move. Dr. Sridharan Bank is an expert in new processes. What he does is mainly to implement new processes in industries. Currently, he is working for Osram, so he is deeply involved in photonics problems. And his topic is to put together, in the best way, two things that are both very important part of our life, namely plastic and light. I hope that they will explain their vision on the way to build together a strategy, sharing their experiences, the practical examples if they want, case histories that can represent benchmark and best practices, on the other hand, that can underline critical points or examples of how not to do something. What we expect from this discussion is to have useful indication, real instructions on the path to improve research, finance, industry, policy interactions. We like to write, as we told with Dr. Muccini, a chart of intents that could be a guideline for all the players that are around this table. So the rules of the discussion are, I will pose them some questions. They have 5 minutes each for the answer. They can have brief replies if they want, could be useful problem. They can also discuss on each other if they want, without exaggerating. Please switch off our mobiles or silent. So the first thing I like to ask them is, what do you need? What do you think you need? I mean, from the other players that are around this table, sitting with us, what should they do for you? How can they do better in your interaction? How can they be more attractive to you? In other words, what is the attitude you expect? Okay, starting with Dr. Nicolaes.
Thank you really very much for inviting me at this round table, and surely the subject of the discussion is very up-to-date and also very challenging, also for a large research center like the CNR. Before I'm going to answer your question, I would like to say a few words, because just to design the boundary of the system that we are living in Italy. In Italy we were not very used to just transfer knowledge. Our tradition was to produce knowledge, but not very much to try to transfer the knowledge that we have produced. That's something that has changed lately. And this is not only in CNR, but also at university. All is due also the way how the career moves. You know, you go on through paper published, not through patent issue. And this makes some difficulty in many of our researchers to use the knowledge that they have developed. Now the thing is changing. It is changing for many reasons. It's changing also because we recognize at the moment, finally, that the researcher has also a social role. We have to develop knowledge, but surely we have to use the knowledge to help our country to grow, and that means that we have to put attention to the knowledge that we have developed. This is the first point that makes Italy a little bit behind other countries, but it is changing very much and very rapidly. The other point that we have, that in Italy there is not too much the idea of investing in research. Investing in research is very complex things, because you have to just rely on the results and you have to be able to evaluate something that is not yet a product, something that could become a product. And to decide to invest in this is not very simple in general. So you need to really trust, and not many investors in Italy are used to do this. That's an another point that I think we should discuss here. Besides this, I must say that in the CNR now we have a lot of more attention for the application of the results. I must say that the economy now is really based mainly on knowledge, so we really have a change also from the industrial point of view. The industry needs to develop or to use knowledge in order to compete in the global market. So at the moment everything is changing, and I can say that I'm very positive in looking at the future in order to better use the research, better interact between research, industry, research and investors. I think there are two different things, because with industry we have a better interaction already, because many industries are supporting our work. With investors, there is a little bit more difficult, but I'm positive that something can change. I don't know if it's okay, or you want me to speak more. I don't want to just take all the time for...
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Now, I would like to know a little bit more. What do you think? Research Research Center conglomerate, CNR, yes. What you could expect from the other players, for policymakers, for example, or investors? How can you expect they afford you?
I can expect from the policymakers some more attention on this point, because I just finished a big debate with the Ministry of Education, because when you evaluate only the research activity, then how I can ask my researcher to work in trying to transfer knowledge? This is one of the points that we should be clear among ourselves. The policy of this ministry has to be very clear, saying that we will really try to just give at least rewards to the researchers that are trying to increase the interaction with industry. This is with industry or investors, of course. This is his point. From the investors' point of view, from industry's point of view, I don't see many problems. I think we already have good interaction. Companies understand that sometimes they can use for a specific subject CNR as a corporate research center. That's something that has changed, because now we have many companies that are interacting very closely with us, not only the ones that are here in this table, but also other companies, I don't know, as Imagro Electronics, for example. They built their research center inside the CNR. And we built a group of CNR inside the SDS. We have done the same with the Ferrari cars. And you know, this interaction in the large industry is very common. With the small, medium-sized industry is more difficult. But this is due to the fact that not always the small and medium-sized industry understand that knowledge is not something that you buy in a given time. At, in a short market, and that's what you need. They have to understand that they need to interact more with the researchers. From a researcher's point of view, I think they really now have done a lot of activity. This year, in 2014, CNR have been interacting with 1,400 small companies, just trying to start something with them and working together on new products and new processes, which is an important number for the Italian standard. From the investors, I think we need a little bit more of trust, because normally the investors, and I had a bad experience in the past personally with this startup that I've worked on, they don't help the researcher. They try to get as soon as possible the results from the research activity. Unfortunately, I was obliged to work with American investors, and everything now is going perfectly. They have invested already more than $60 million on the research in the biotech area, and the biotech area is a more difficult area for investing, because really you have to trust people for a long period before you can get some dollar or euros back. And in Italy, this is really difficult. That's, you perhaps need more investors, but surely at the moment it is not very simple. Surely it's much better in a software area, it's better also in materials area, but when you go on biotech, with all the time that you need for testing in your product, phase one, phase two, phase three, all the problems that are related to product that has to become a pharmaceutical. That really needs a very strong, economically strong investor that believes in and knows, understands what you are trying to do, understands very well what are the key points of your invention. That's something that's interesting. In general, as I was saying, I'm positive because the attitude is changing in Italy. And that's something, also this round table is a signal that something is changing. We have an industrialist here, we have some investor here, we have a professor here, we have a
professor then.
We have surely many experiences, and all of them are discussing about this problem that is, I think, is a key problem for Italy. It's not only because we need to make only startups, because we need to make a reindustrialization of our companies. They have to change completely. They have not to work on trying to reduce the cost of their product. They have to work in trying to increase the quality and amount of knowledge that is in the product. That means that interaction among ourselves is the key point for the future, not of Siena, but of Italy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's very clear. Professor Bianchi, you are nodding over me. Do you agree?
Yeah, thank you so much for inviting this conference. I'm just following what Gio Nicolai said. Let me just come back to one index that is the European Union Innovation Scoreboard, that is the index this week, where we are in the European contest. This instrument is to measure if a country is to be considered leader, follower, moderate, or not. Unfortunately, the country is considered a moderate innovator. The regional analysis is different because some regions in the north, Emilia-Romagna, Piemonte, Friuli, are considered follower, but the country is considered a moderate innovator. It's considered a country having a high number of individuals which are real leader in innovation. But the country is not a real leader, or at least a follower in innovation. Why? Because we don't have this concept that Gino said, that is the system, the national innovation system, the regional innovation system. That means that all the different players are playing the same game. So your question, what are you asking the others to play in the same team? Nothing more. We are playing in the same team. But let me say something more. First, it's very clear what Gino Nicolai is saying. We are coming from a tradition of having just only a few big companies and a number of small and medium-sized companies. Traditionally, the real innovators were the small companies. And the problem for us was, how can we allow them to innovate? How can we allow them to grow up rapidly, not just over time? And how can we consider that they can work in the global context? I don't want to say avoiding the risk in vision, but controlling the risk. And the answer is the system that means to have big research infrastructure, and this is the role of CNO, the basic infrastructure of the country. And on the other side, a number, a variety of instruments to integrate the companies and the research. This is the key point. The key point is we have to strengthen the basic infrastructure of research, and this is the first volley of Horizon, the capacity to use all the structural funds all together in a very integrated way in order to focus the capacity to generate innovation, because innovation is not just machinery, it's not just human resources, it's not just the basic resources, it's the capacity to use all these things all together. And third, is the real change in the mind of the people. In a global economy, we have an enlargement in the extent of the market. And in fact, we have a rapid increase in the international trade. But at the same time, there is a segmentation of demand. We have to decide what we have to do in this country. Just follow the emerging countries, reducing the cost of labor, producing scale products, or on the other side, to produce top quality products, having the capacity to embody the individual intelligence, the collective intelligence of the system. My answer is very clear. And what we have done in this region, in a very integrated level of the region with the center of Europe, is to define the strategy of industrial policy. This is very clear. We invested in basic structure. We want to reinforce the basic research infrastructure. Let me say just only a few words on this issue. In this region, we have a number of big data centers. Cineca is the national consortium of a university managing most of the research data of all the university systems in Italy. We have the National Institute of Nuclear Research, we have CNN. Okay. We have to reinforce the relation among these centers in order to create the real hub of big data in Italy. Let me say in South of Europe. This is something that we have to discuss together later on, of course. Second is materials. Materials, the argument of this day. New materials. New usage of materials. New capacity to define specific materials for specific usage. Once upon a time, we had the materials and the technology was to use the existing materials. Now we are in an open situation. We have needs and we can design and produce materials for responding to specific needs. And third is cellular biomass. People have to decide for priority, and we have decided. We have to build up here in this region the big hub for instrument and the infrastructure for research. In this context, we can also embed small, medium-sized companies, big companies, working and using these facilities. Looking for creating infrastructure of connection. Researchers, university professors, they have to speak with the language of the discipline. Companies have to speak with the proper lexicon of the companies. We need people speaking together, understanding the the different needs and translating the needs of the one in the language of the others. Researchers has the duty to produce good research, and businessmen has the duty to produce profits. In the middle, there is a number of people having the difficult duty to use the people to speak together and to produce together. Well, this is the real role of organization. I want to say also the economies, but this could be a just spot. Now, let me say, we have to build up the innovation system, and this is our collective duty.
Very interesting to hear what Dr. Pezzolani is going to say. But Dr. Durados first. The role of the European
position and the regional position, and of course we feel a lot of the same needs and urgencies. I can agree with a lot that has been said so far, and perhaps I should frame this into the European point of view, in which we start, let's say our policy starts from the paradox that a lot of excellent research is done in Europe, a lot of publications, but then the commercialization of results is often not done in Europe. And this is a loss for the European taxpayers. So then the main question is how to bring this innovation to be done in Europe for European. And the first answer must be to develop models of collaborations that are more strategic, more strong, more effective. And I talk about collaboration between industry and researchers, but also between all actors that can contribute to innovation, because innovation is not something that happens like this. It requires a lot of time and a lot of contributions. So investors, yes, private investors, and the issue about identifying investing in high tech and risky research enterprises. The issue of competences, what was mentioned before, do we have the right competences to really cover the full spectrum? And we thought about who else can contribute to bringing research results to the market. And then there is the crucial element that the added value for society from research comes only through companies. So this link must be very strong. And by this, I mean that researchers should try to think about working on solving problems for industry, to work in very strong collaboration with them, but also to industry, to invest into innovation, to be brave and sustainable, and to invest in young people, and really tell clearly what are the competences that are needed, that they need in order to bring innovation to the market. And to invest in bodies, the needs that I see is that they should be complementary to Horizon 2020. So not to duplicate or not to say to researchers, do it, do it in Europe, apply for European funds. But there should be a strategy that somehow develops a national and regional policy that complements Horizon 2020. So that the region and the nation decides what are the strategic areas that should be kept or should be pushed, and then finds in Europe the complementary instruments to really close the circle and bring this to the society.
Thank you. Dr. Wilkins, Photonics 21 clearly is an attempt to do what Dr. Rosa was saying, create a collaboration or strategy on a single topic.
So this is actually what we're trying to do for many years now, and we have seen that there is a significant shift in mindset in Europe, and I think we can praise the European Commission that that they have moved in that direction. I mean, we're not living in a perfect world still. If you look at Horizon 2020, so this industrial leadership part of the program is really on innovation. And then we have another pillar on societal challenges, which I believe is the end user industry more or less, which still between the innovation pillar where technologies are developed and the societal challenges where the end user industry is sitting, we still don't have a very good link at the moment. I think this needs to be increased. But going a step back, looking at Europe as a whole and the member states, I think what we need to recognize is that that our competitors are sitting outside Europe. I often see discussions where member states in Europe are compared against each other. I think that's not the issue in Europe. It's China, Asia, it's the US, and we need to find a way how to become more competitive. And we have many aspects, an inefficient funding system still. So we as the Photonics PPP, I mean, our core role is to unite the community, the industry, and the research area, and come up with the right topics for funding, for collaborative research. And I think this process is established, it works quite well, but the PPP has a funding of 700 million for 7 years for the whole of Europe. So that's a drop in the bucket. So this will not change Europe completely. And I think we need to change the system. And this means at national level also to make choices. So which are the areas the country should invest and focus on. We often see that it's so broad and so unspecified that you will not have any critical mass in investing in your right area, I think. Speed also is an issue. We currently reaching out to the regional level and the national level. We try to combine our photonics PPP activities with national funding activities and regional funding activities, and it is quite difficult. So these are different worlds altogether, and it's very complex. So in a perfect world, you would have a Horizon 2020 Photonics PPP research project, which is naturally located in a region where stakeholder is sitting, and probably with regional money, you could make the next step going through pilot production or so. But the links between both funding systems are not established yet. So, and we have a hard time finding the right guys in the regions and trying to understand what we can do in order to make the whole process more efficient. So, and coming to the investor side, what we see, and this is not only true in Europe, but I think worldwide, the general trend for at least private equity investors is to invest in software. For a good reason, I think, there's a very quick return on invest. You see, with a considerable amount of money, you can, within 1 or 2 years, see whether this company will fly or not. So, and hardware is expensive. So it's really difficult to find the right investors. We've had an investor conference in Rome, beginning of this year in April, where we invited young companies and investors. Young companies pitched, and we tried to establish the link between the young companies and the private equity side. But overall, I would say there is plenty of things to do for us in order to speed up innovation. And speed, to me, is a critical issue for Europe.
Thank you. Dr. Pecorani, I think you have many questions to answer.
Thank you for the invitation, and the first question I have is for the public. How many of you are involved in this research project now? I would like to see a raise of hands. Now, how many of you are trying to solve a technology problem, and how many of you are trying to solve the market problem? First, the technology problem.